Hello everyone, welcome back to my video, Brush Up Your Basics with ASLP. So today's topic is 20 tips to avoid common mistakes while performing PTA. I am pretty sure the professionals who have been practicing for a while must be aware of these points, but it will be really helpful for all those juniors who don't pay much attention while they are observing their seniors in their clinical postings. So let's just begin. So my first tip is interaction. It's really important to interact not only with the parent, caregiver, but also with the client, irrespective of the age, whether it's a toddler, preschooler, adolescent, adult or geriatric, we must interact verbally or non-verbally. Interaction builds rapport between the client and the clinician, and most importantly, it tells us about the client's behavior and cognition, which are very important aspects for diagnosis and referring the client for further evaluation. Coming to my second tip, stop anticipating that every patient is deaf. This is a very important point to be considered. We should stop anticipating that every client coming for the evaluation is deaf, and thus we shouldn't talk loudly with the client or start using gestures or sign language. What if the client have just come for the normal routine medical checkup? Now coming to the third tip. Otoscopic examination is a must. An otoscope potentially gives view of the ear canal and tympanic membrane. I have made a detailed video about otoscopic examination. If you are interested to watch, I'll put the link in the description below. Now coming to my fourth tip. Poor conditioning can lead to wrong diagnosis. While conditioning the child, we need to be very patient. Otherwise, a child having hearing sensitivity with the normal limits can also be diagnosed as having moderate to severe hearing loss. Fifth tip, beware of vague instructions. Giving the instructions to the client after putting the headphone is a big no. Instructions should always be given before and should be clear and to the point. Coming to the sixth tip, asking the patient to remove eyeglasses, earrings, headbands, hair clips, and ornaments. It should be removed for both comfort and proper fitting of headphones and bone vibrator. Seventh tip, removal of amplification device. Whether it is body level behind the ear in the canal or completely in the canal, it must be removed and kept away safely. Eighth tip, chewing gums or candy must be disposed of. Keeping in mind that anatomically eating or drinking can interfere in the procedure, while the headphones are on, client should be instructed not to do so. Ninth tip, beware of ear canal collapse, which gives false impression of conductive hearing loss. We should check whether putting pressure on the external ear seems to cause the ear canal to close. This is important because the pressure exerted by the headphone might similarly cause collapse of the ear canal and give the false impression of a conductive hearing loss. 10th tip, not desirable to allow the patient to apply the headset themselves because the fit may not be optimal and thus the optimal results may not be found. Coming to tip number 11, to ensure BC placement is proper. We should inspect the mastoid bone and check for common problems such as hair under the bone vibrator, oily skin, oddly shaped or narrow mastoid bone that make it hard to place the bone vibrator without slipping and without touching the pinna. Tip number 12, restricting patient's movement. It is wise to instruct the patient to keep their head still, not to talk and not to use their phone during the evaluation. Tip number 13. To provide a strain relief for bone conduction wire. The patient should be instructed to tell if the bone vibrator moves in any way. It is also a good idea to provide a strain relief so that an unintentional tug on the wire will not dislocate the vibrator. This can be done with a small clip or by looping the wire under the patient's collar. Tip number 14. Orientation of the patient. The patient should be seated in a reasonably comfortable chair. Armrests are very desirable because they make almost every kind of response method like hand or finger raising easier for the patient. Chair that lean back should be avoided because the movement are distracting and pose a safety problem for some patient. Tip number 15. Start with better ear. It helps the patient to get familiarized with the procedure, thus when evaluating the poorer ear, thresholds are accurate. Tip number 16. Ballpark threshold estimate. Testing begins by familiarizing the patient with a 1 kHz test tone. Carhart and Jerger did this by first presenting a test tone lasting 1 to 2 seconds at 30 dB HL if the patient seems to be normal, or at 70 dB HL if the patient appears to have a hearing impairment. If the patient does not respond to the first tone, then its level would be raised by 15 dB until the tone is heard. Tip number 17. Threshold search. The appropriate procedure is to lower the level of the tone by 10 dB after every yes response and raise the level of the tone by 5 dB after every no response. Tip number 18. Testing frequencies and testing order. Pure tone thresholds should be obtained in this order for each ear. The 1 kHz retest is done as a reliability check and is expected to be within plus or minus 5 dB. Tip number 19. Habit of taking common BC. Omitting bone conduction testing would cause conductive impairment to be missed. Now coming to the last tip, tip number 20. Not to miss out TFTs. Tuning fork test plays a vital role in supporting the diagnosis. Thus, PTA without TFT is incomplete. So with this we come to the end. I hope this video was helpful for you all. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Thank you for watching. You can also follow me on my Instagram account. See you all in my next video.